Yeah, I guess there's some confusion on the what do you call it? The who will speak first? Why I want to speak first today is because in Malaysia, I've been known as a warrant specialist. But in Hong Kong, there are many warrants expert, heavily god of warrant, like this warrant here. He's born. The name is also already warrant already. How to compete? I mean, in Hong Kong market, there are a lot of Tin Wong, Tin Hao, Lun Hao, Lun. Those are heavenly god, heavenly queen warrants. Because Hong Kong is a very developed warrant market. So today, instead of speaking on warrant, I speak a little bit on TDR. It's a concept of, or I wouldn't exactly call it a derivatives, but it is a what I call it, a form of dual listings. And recently, there has been a very encouraging a response to the stocks who are going to list in Taiwan. And I'm just going to highlight some of the ways that you can actually profit from investing in these candidates who are actually going to Taiwan for listing. I can't move my PowerPoint. Is it supposed to move? This one? Oh, okay. Sorry. Anyway, the theme of my topic today is more on Greater China investing. And we have to find out where these companies are listed. Okay, as an introduction, China companies, they are listed, they can be listed in Shanghai, Shenzhen, and these are known as A shares and B shares. A shares are only available to China, mainland Chinese citizens. Foreigners, including Hong Kong citizens, can't invest directly into A shares, but they can buy B shares, which are quoted in US dollar. But the B shares aren't that popular so far. And for overseas Chinese or foreigners, we can only participate in the growth of the China economy by purchasing China H shares, which are actually shares, similar companies. They have two classes of shares, A shares and H shares, and they are separately. You can't change them, not fungible. Okay, stocks like PetroChina, they have a H shares and they have an A shares. Typically, A shares trade at a significant premium than H shares. For example, if Sinopec A is trading at about 13 bucks, the H is only trading like 6 something, so it's almost double. Okay? Then there is another class of shares called red chips. Red chips are actually, the business is in China, but the holding company is in an offshore island or outside of China, something like China Mobile and CNOOC. These are examples of red chips. And red chips, they are not listed in China yet. Of course, the hot topic this year is that the possibility of China Mobile going back to issue A shares. And of course, Hong Kong also have a lot of international companies with Chinese interests. For example, Taiwanese-owned companies, which I would elaborate a little bit more on later. And of course, in Taiwan, there are companies, local companies, foreign companies. Foreign companies can list directly in the Taiwan Stock Exchange, or they can list via Taiwan Depository Receipts. I will elaborate the concept of DR in my next slide. And of course, you see some companies in China listing in Malaysia, Singapore, and the US. So these are all the markets. And in fact, some of the European markets, there are also AIMS. I mean, the London Exchange, there is some China companies there as well. Okay, why I say Taiwan? Because Taiwan has one of the highest PE ratio across major markets in the world. As you can see in this particular slide, as of December 2009, this source is from the Taiwan Stock Exchange. I'm not putting this up, okay? And it gives you the historical PE ratio of major markets in the world. And you can see that in N2009, the PE ratio of the Taiwan stock market is 110 times. Malaysia is just now what Pong say, what, 14, 15 times? This is 110 times, okay? And you think China is high? China is only 27 in Shanghai, about 40 over times in Shenzhen. And Hong Kong is a very cheap 21.9. Oh, sorry, 17.6. So you can see that Hong Kong shares are relatively undervalued as compared with the major indices around the world. Okay? So which brings to the point that companies who are listed in one exchange to seek better valuation for their shares would then explore markets where they can get higher valuation. Okay? A lot of companies, very typical in Malaysia, a lot of second liner, third liner, they are good companies trading at single digit PEs, sometimes even 3-5 times PE. I mean, this kind of PE we might as well don't list, right? So in order to create or seek out better value, so some of these companies can consider what we call a dual listing. To address the issue, they can go for second listing or dual listing, and there are many destinations that they can go through. And dual listing can be achieved by listing the shares directly or through depository receipts. Okay, what are depository receipts? Okay, depository receipts is a negotiable financial instruments issued by a bank or broker which represent a foreign company's public traded securities. The precondition is that the underlying company must be listed in an existing exchange. For example, if Malaysia, we have an ABC company, they can actually get a bank or a broker in Taiwan to issue a DR, a depository receipt on their shares. Of course, the bank must be willing to sponsor them, or else they can't list. If you list, although nobody trades, no point, right? So the most common type of DR is American depository receipts. I mean, this is the largest market. Major Chinese companies like PetroChina, Sinopec, China Mobile has ADR traded in the US. So sometimes you can actually continue trading Hong Kong shares deep in your midnight if you have nothing better to do. But sometimes you get value, can make a lot of money on. Okay. Taiwanese depository receipts. I think this must be something that, I don't know, have anyone heard of TDR before and can have a show of hands? One. Okay, I'll tell to the other 99.9%. This TDR market had actually existed since 1998. And before 2009, only 5 has existed at any point in time. Remember a few years back, there was one company, Taiwanese-owned companies in Malaysia, Canmark, they wanted to issue TDR, but after a while, the interest died away, they say they're putting the thing on hold. So you can see that prior to 2009, TDR is a very quiet, very cold market. In 2009, something happened, a very, very significant year for the TDR market, okay? There are a growth of almost 10 counters, 10 TDRs in 2009. The reason? In 2009, the Taiwanese Stock Exchange is probably one of the best performing, outperforming the Hong Kong and China market, up almost 100%. You can see the PE growth from low teens or it was single digit prior years to 100 times PE. So you can see the actual growth amount of the Taiwanese Stock Exchange. So comes a rally, and there is a signing of this MOU and ECFA with China. You don't have to know what it is, but it's something to do with China. They can open up something. Because if I tell you too much, I'm not an economist. I believe most of you are not. So you know that this is something that create a facilities, better flow of trades and financial sector between China and Taiwan. And very important, stocks listed in the Hong Kong Stock Exchange are eligible to be included as a TDR. That means the Taiwanese Stock Exchange will actually have a list of approved exchange where the primary listing of the companies are listed. And amongst them, Malaysia and Singapore, South Africa, Thailand. So these are the kind of exchange where the things are approved. Just to show you what are the companies already traded under TDR in Taiwan, it is in Chinese.